Good morning. Welcome to the TI panel session on electrification. So as we are talking to the term electrification, probably need to get a level set on what that actually means. So for you guys, what does electrification of the vehicle mean?
Well, many people think that electrification of passenger vehicles means pure electric vehicles, right? But this is not completely true, because it's not only about having an electric motor for driving the car, but it is also about offloading the combustion engine with electric assisted functions, like, for example, electric water pumps or fuel pumps, active suspension. And this together allows for higher efficiency, lower fuel consumption. It is also eco-friendly, right? And it also improves performance of the car, either in terms of fuel consumption or even acceleration and so on.
Yeah, and there's some recuperation that's involved in that as well. And
yeah, this is correct, because you can do energy harvesting even from active suspension, right? So you can actually get the energy back from all those bumps. And the idea is to completely eliminate any energy which turns into heat, right? Like braking energy.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So basically you're eliminating the belt.
Correct. From the system. Yes.
And so if we're looking at those design challenges related to an electric or a hybrid electric vehicle, can you comment on what those would be?
So I think one of the biggest things with the vehicle electrification, and again, it's a scale in terms of the voltage level that needs to be supported, but as you get to higher voltage systems, there are just a lot of new design challenges that come into play. You have things like isolation and safety that become, you know, really critical for those systems. And then also just the, you know, as the voltage levels go up and the power levels are increasing, the need for greater efficiency in each of those electrified vehicles subsystems just becomes more and more critical in the overall design of the car.
Yeah, and safety is probably a primary concern here. We're dealing with a very high voltage in a system, and we've got to basically ensure it's safe. So any thoughts on functional safety or how the automotive ASIL functionality fits in?
Yeah, so you know, we're talking about a moving vehicle here with people in it. We're talking about a vehicle that's going to be parked in a house. So it has to be safe. And we've heard of different challenges that electric vehicles have had in the market. And we know that now our customers are demanding higher and higher ASIL levels. So now for ISO 26262, we're actually seeing ASIL D as becoming almost standard in my portion of the electrification. And what we do is just to provide them as much information, as much diagnostic information, to actually be able to understand if the car is in a safe state or not, and be able to take it from whatever state it's in to a safe state, and decide, make all the decisions with the information we provide them with how do they want to get in a safe state. Do they want to completely shut the car off? Do they want to just slow down? And so we provide a lot of good information that allows a customer and a lot of systems and diagnostics to help them get to those higher functional safety levels that they need to meet with electrification.
Yeah, very important, right? Especially in the adoption of the vehicle, it has to be safe. So if we look into some of the markets, especially in Asia, where electric rates are actually relatively low, your ranges are relatively low, EV is actually the preferred way to go, where you're plugging in and charging. Can you talk a little bit about that evolution to the full electric vehicle?
Yeah, I think one of the most interesting things that have come from, again, the city model for using pure electric vehicles, people even then still want to be able to charge faster. So again, extending the range means a lot of times putting a bigger battery in, and it just means that you have to be able to charge at either a faster rate or, you know, again, the same rate, but trying to get higher efficiency throughput on the power that's going into the vehicle to charge it. So that's just continued to evolve. I think the expectations from consumers will continue to go up in terms of getting that charge time down, and the overall distance you can drive per charge to be increased.
Yeah, and when you look at range, one of the areas that you could help is the weight of the vehicle, of course, right? And if you see a lot of the internal combustion engines today, the second heaviest component outside of the powertrain is actually the wiring harness, right? So as we transfer to EV, one of the advantages we get is eliminating the size of the cabling going into those vehicles and still being able to drive those next generation electrification systems.
Yeah, this is very correct, but I would like to also add on top that it's not only fast charging, but it is also bidirectional energy transfer. So not only from the grid to the car, but also from the car to the grid. As a matter of fact, actually most new projects we see for battery management systems, onboard chargers, and DC-DC converters, all of them are bidirectional, right? Because when you think about it, we have a lot of renewable sources like windmills, solar panels, and so on. And they have a slight problem that they cannot deliver energy all time long, right? Not on the constant level. So with such a car, we are able to cover actually those energy peaks and still maintain the grid on the stable level, which is extremely beneficial, especially for remote areas in some parts of the world.
And that makes a lot of sense. You're sitting in Texas, for example, or California, the sun's always shining. You're in a parking lot right now, solar energy is coming in. You're not really using the vehicle. You're able to basically have a charge system that you're able to bring back into your house later on and power it during the non-daylight hours.
Yeah, this is very correct. And I believe it's a brilliant idea. And actually, this is the future, how to make the grid sustainable.
So tell me a little bit about the 48-volt system and how that's helping the auto manufacturers.
Well, 48-volt systems is a big thing, at least for Europe, where car automakers have to fulfill a very tight CO2 emission regulations given by the European Union. And for example, as of 2020, the limit was set to 95 grams of CO2 per kilometer, right? And this is extremely tough limit to achieve. And there, for this reason, they need to find a way how to do this. And those 48-volt systems turn out to be probably the cheapest and simplest way how to actually fulfill these requirements. So the idea is that you have a 12-volt battery on one side, the traditional one, and the 48-volt battery on the other side. And then you put a bidirectional DC-DC converter in the middle, which is able to transfer energy back and forth. And also you implement a unit, which is called a starter generator. And this replaces the generator or alternator we have in combustion engine cars, standard cars, and also we get a starter from it. And it allows energy recuperation and also helps with torque assist. So during acceleration, you get for a limited period of time, like 10, 20 seconds, you get instant power from zero speed, right? 10 to 20 kilowatts. You accelerate the car, the feeling is great, but you can still have a very small engine, like 1.2 liter engine. It's a brilliant idea.
Yeah, it's a huge advantage too, because if you're in bumper-to-bumper traffic, if you're an internal combustion engine, by definition, if you're going 0 miles, your MPG is zero, right? So this is a very efficient way to reduce emissions as well as saving on the gas price as well, right?
Correct.
Gentlemen, thanks for the conversation. A great topic today. Really appreciate the time. To check out more information, our design resources that will help you speed your time to market, follow the link below or go to ti.com/electrification.